Joining me now are political analyst Michael Genovese and David Katz, former assistant US attorney for Los Angeles. Okay, so that 8-page letter from the White House counsel on Tuesday to Speaker Pelosi, you know, which outlined a strategy of total non-cooperation, period, no help whatsoever, now comes with an addendum courtesy of Donald Trump. Here he is.
If Pelosi holds a vote on the floor on impeachment and commits to the rules of previous impeachment proceedings, you'll participate in that investigation?
Yeah, if the rules are fair, because I don't know how, I don't know exactly your definition. If Republicans get a fair shake.
So, David, we'll start with your legal opinion. During both the Nixon and Clinton impeachments, the House did allow the president's attorneys to attend all the impeachment-related sessions, review evidence, question witnesses. So far, Speaker of the House Nancy Pelosi has not allowed that to happen. She's breaking tradition. Is she breaking the law?
Well, she's not breaking the law at all. The law is that the House can set the rules for an impeachment proceeding. And if there are different rules right after the Civil War or back during Watergate or during Clinton, that was because that's what the House wanted to do. The House was, of course, Republican when it voted to impeach, that is to charge Clinton. So what's ironic, too, is that many of the people who are screaming the loudest about how unfair the procedures are in the House were actually House managers of the Clinton impeachment who are now in the Senate or who are the vice president like Pence and who are urging the removal of Clinton for private sexual conduct. So there's nothing unfair about the rules. First of all, the trial will be in the Senate. But even regarding the charges, the president has a lot of rights, even in the House, and his rights are being preserved. Remember, there's about 45% Republicans in the House. They're allowed to ask questions. They're allowed access to the witnesses. If they want to call witnesses, there's no reason why some of those witnesses couldn't be called. But let's keep our eye on the ball, John, of what's really going on. What's really going on is that President Trump is stonewalling, not allowing anyone to be called. He hasn't allowed Sondland, who flew all the way over from Brussels and who is his ambassador and who was supposedly willing to testify and supposedly was going to offer favorable testimony, although you wonder if that really would have been what happened. And he wasn't allowed to testify by the administration. Before that, McGahn, the former chief of staff, wasn't allowed to testify. So the stonewalling, the lack of what you would consider due or fair process, has been all on Trump's side, not on Pelosi's and not on Adam Schiff's part.
David, you make some very good points there. You know, this is a president who is incredibly skilled at playing. So given that, is the politics here for Democrats take that opportunity away from the president, adopt the same type of procedures as past impeachments? What would be the downside of that?
Well, I think eventually that's what's going to happen. But the president is arguing, I think, a little bit backwards. In point of fact, if you look back at Watergate, they had a thorough investigation before they brought impeachment charges. And so that was the Irvin Committee, where you had great television drama, where every day people were glued to the television set watching the testimony of John Dean and of Butterfield and of all the Watergate characters. You did the investigation first, and then you decided about impeachment. And the president's arguing that, no, you first have to decide on impeachment, and then you do the investigation. Well, you don't do that in criminal cases. Why do it here? And so the president's basic position is, look, those guys shouldn't impeach me because they're not going to be fair because they don't like me. Well, that's not the case. Certainly the Democrats do not support the president. They will eventually impeach him. But the process has to go on, this process. If you look at that letter that was submitted by the president's counsel, it's kind of the Swiss cheese letter because it's full of holes. The court cases they even refer to support Congress investigating and issuing subpoenas. So they do say there are some limits to that. But in essence, even the court cases that are cited don't support what the president believes.
Well, the president also has another skill, and that's taking a grain of truth, twisting and blowing it up out of all context. Here he is doing just that.
They heard a whistleblower who came out with a false story. You know, people say, oh, it was fairly close. It wasn't close at all. What the whistleblower said to what the call was. We have a transcribed calls, and the call was a perfect call. Then it turns out that the whistleblower is a Democrat, strong Democrat, and is working with one of my opponents as a Democrat that I might end up running against.
David, that was the president playing the ultimate victim here. The problem is what he said is simply taken out of context. It's simply not true, or it's an outright lie.
Well, that's one of the problems right here, is that he wants to play the victim, but the reality is that the transcribed call is what hurts him. It's not what the whistleblower had to say about it. It's what is corroborated. The whistleblower was corroborated by the released transcript of the call. The call itself is what the strong evidence is. It shows a quid pro quo by the president. It shows that he wanted a favor, politically and personally, $400 million of military aid that Ukraine desperately needed to fend off Russian aggression. And the money was never released until it was known in September that there was a whistleblower out there. And the transcript was never released until it was known that there was going to be a whistleblower complaint about it. Now we have yet a second whistleblower. Remember the last week defense was that it was hearsay? Well, we don't need the hearsay because we have the transcript, but now there's actually a second whistleblower who heard the actual call. On top of that, 10 other people heard it. It was put on a super secret server where it didn't belong, which was for covert operations. Why was it hidden? If it wasn't embarrassing to the president, why was it hidden? And it's also come out from the whistleblower that other things were hidden on there. Was there a call with Turkey on there trading a Trump Tower Istanbul for withdrawing the support now that's just happened, a quid pro quo with Putin and the Russians? Well, that's also on the super server. So that's why it does make sense for Congress to go down this road and to try to get those documents, not just impeach now, but to actually try, at least for a few weeks, maybe for a couple of months, to really press the investigations, to really get what they have, to ask for expedited review by the courts if that's what needed. Not get into a Mueller situation, John, where they just let the thing get so old and stale in people's minds, but move with dispatch, move with alacrity, but find out the many more things they can find out. Get this ambassador who was trashed and brought home from Ukraine because she wouldn't play ball with Giuliani. Get right. This longtime advisor to Trump. Get her before the Congress. Keep the momentum going. There is some more evidence that should be plumbed.
It does seem that that's the strategy the Democrats are using. But, you know, in Trumpian world, the bizarre world of Donald Trump, this strategy of stonewalling and, you know, essentially taking things out of context is working. Here's one of his latest tweets. Only 25% want the president impeached, which is pretty low considering the volume of fake news coverage, but pretty high considering the fact that I did nothing wrong. It's all just a continuation, witch hunt, blah, 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 blah. But in the real world, opinion polls are showing support for impeachment. It's going in one direction, and that's up. Even opinion polls over at Fox News. Here's the question they asked. Do you think President Trump should be impeached and removed from office? 51% said yes. And this is Fox News. So, Michael, even though that 25% number that the president is quoting is not correct, it's not a good sign when you're boasting that only a quarter of the country wants you to stand trial for high crimes and misdemeanors and be removed from office.
Yes, but Donald Trump controls, number one, the bully pulpit, number two, the bully Twitter account. And he has an ability, a masterful ability, to control events, to control discussion, and to control circumstances surrounding discussion. And so while his comment about 25% is absurd, people are talking about it. We're talking about it. The president sets the agenda and he sets the confines of our discussion. And the fact that what he says is often not true, or made up, or something that's made to puff himself up, that's what we talk about because that's what he delivers. The bully pulpit is an incredibly effective tool in the hands of someone who is as effective at communicating as Donald Trump. Give him credit. He's able to dominate the public space. And in spite of the fact that we call him out on these things, he gets the first word and he gets the last word.
Okay, well, the last word for us, we'll go to Joe Biden, the former vice president and Democrat candidate, on why he believes this president should be impeached.
He believes he can and will get away with anything he does. We all laughed when he said he could stand in the middle of Fifth Avenue and shoot someone and get away with it. It's no joke. He's shooting holes in the Constitution, and we cannot let him get away with it.
So very quickly to David, then I want to come back to Michael. But, you know, David first, this impeachment inquiry, it seems more about Trump versus the Constitution as opposed to Trump versus Democrats.
Well, Trump is shooting holes in the Constitution. And I think it's clear now that whether it's sooner or a little bit later, the House will vote to impeach him, to charge him with many articles. And then there'll be a trial in the Senate. And I think that will call into question what the Senate really sees itself as. Do they want to be laughed at? Do they want to be like legislatures in a lot of the world where they have great power on paper, but they just kowtow to autocrats and don't inquire into what the government is doing? Do they want to be that kind of Senate? And I think a combination of their own institutional pride and also the fall in the polls and a majority even on Fox polls saying that they want the president removed, I think is going to move those senators. They're not going to give up their six-year terms so they can go down with Trump. Why should they?
Yeah. Okay, very quickly, Michael, when do you think that there will be any movement among Republican lawmakers? Because we are seeing movement among Republican voters.
There already is some movement visible, and it was on the story you led with. Turkey invading forces in Syria that are fighting the Kurds. So you're seeing some holes being punched in Trump, holes that he invited. And so some Republicans are getting pretty disgusted with him on national security grounds. Question is, will the voters push those Republicans in relatively safe or swing districts to go against the president? That doesn't seem likely right now, but this is a very movable, public opinion is very movable on this. The more that's revealed, the further you go into the process, the more people start to listen, pay attention, and that's when the president is really in difficult times.
Okay, so Michael and David, thanks to you both. Appreciate you being with us.
Thank you.
Great being here.